Recorded Books presents Stuff Nobody Taught You by Summer McStravick, narrated by the author.
A few thoughts. Welcome to a very different ride than the one you were perhaps expecting when you picked up this book with its perky purple cover and peppy earnest subtitle. Yay, personal growth, you thought, and aw, I could use some direction. Gosh, I want to feel amazing. Well, for starters, you will get heaps of both, but you're also going to get a ton of salty language. A fuck ton, to be precise. If that bothers you, put this book down. I've always had a sailor's mouth. In fact, I learned all my bad words from my mom, who also believes in the magic of language. 30 years ago, I went to school for writing, graduated with a bunch of writing awards, and have wondered ever since why I didn't actually go on to write. Well, maybe it's because I stopped writing the word fuck all these years. Words are here to make an impact. It's embarrassing that I even have to explain myself, but there it is. Every word I write is a trigger, or I hope it will be a trigger. Triggers make things pop. Salty language makes things pop. And you're here to pop. In addition to filling you with bad language, I'm hoping to possibly excite your senses of indignity and judgment, because that's often where the gold is for your next step. And if you don't feel indignant, then get ready for a plain old fun, happy, and saucy ride with me. Because feeling something is fun. It means you're alive. I'm alive. We have so much work to do, and we've all been so afraid to do that work. Dancing around the corners of our lives in mincing little steps, trying to stay safe and be liked, which we think will make us rich or loved or both. I've done that for ages, and I am done with it. Maybe you are too. So I want you to head straight in with me, which is going to mean giving a lot of fucks. Which brings us to some questions. Why are you here? Why did you pick up this book? Why are you even thinking about giving me a whole gob of your time? I think, like me, you're here because you want to shake yourself awake again and maybe even figure out how you got here to this exact point in your life. Not only that, you want to know where to go next and maybe even how to go about doing that. You're at a pause point, the needle in the groove between the songs. And in this moment, you hear your own tired exhale. I know, because that's where I am too. As I sit here in my baggy lavender pajamas on this Friday morning in the spring, typing and thinking as we start this journey together. I'd rather be out walking the dog or chasing down fresh lettuce in my garden. But if I don't sit here and do this with you, then Monday morning, I'll be doing the same thing as always. Feeling the same exact way as always. So I'm going to do the thing, to write the thing, with you at my side, and you? You've picked yourself as my accountability partner. Very cool, thank you. More on this later. Now, a wee bit of practical. There are worksheets illustrating the end of chapter prompts that you can download here, www.flowdreaming.com/prompts. They're all prettied up and will make the work more fun. You might also want to follow up with my podcast, Flow Dreaming. Also, M.E.School is an actual real thing. Everything you're going to read stems from my live online M.E.School program that I teach to a cadre of very enthusiastic students as I guide them through these concepts and their own exciting interchanges. You're welcome to explore M.E.School too. I would love to see you take that next step at www.flowdreaming.com/M.E.School. Now, let's boogie. Part 1. Open Your Eyes. Chapter 1. The Lavender Pajamas. When I think about the world of personal growth, wow. Have I been thick in the trenches of it for a long time? I've probably read all the same self-help books as you. I've likely been to the same conventions, retreats, and summits. I've shaken hands with peyote, shaken my belly with tantra, and loosened my throat chakra with some pranic breathwork. I rebirthed my inner child, reikied my way to the fifth dimension, and used the purple light to reset my cellular clock. I practiced the art of simplifying my life, created my morning rituals, and sat through more than one seminar on how to achieve my personal best in under 90 days. And that's only in the last few years. My heart, like yours, is drawn to the unusual and the sublime. It's drawn to things that make us feel free or happier or both. It's drawn especially to practices and ways of thinking that help me discover my life and the universe through both energetic means as well as the practical, which ultimately helps me know myself a bit better. To know yourself is to love yourself. At least it should be. When I was in my 20s, I mailed a letter looking for work to a local personal growth publishing company housed in a boxy white warehouse by some scrubby canyons. I didn't know much about what they published other than that a famous author had founded it. At the time, where I lived, there were only two publishing companies big enough for anyone to have heard of. After all, it wasn't New York City. It came down to this publisher or the other one, who made children's picture books of stock photo zoo animals for the under four set. And I was a graphic designer and 20-something and hungry to break into the publishing big leagues. Toddler books weren't going to do it. So I asked the personal growth publisher, did they want me to lay out their books? And yes, they did. The answer was yes. You know those moments when a thread of fate seems to branch off onto that road of personal growth? It's nothing you'd notice in the beginning, just an opportunity. A new person you meet, maybe, or that weird urge to try something new, like baking with butterscotch instead of chocolate. You've heard of the butterfly effect. It's where one small change can lead to a vastly different outcome. The classic example of when the flapping of the butterfly's wings in Argentina can lead to rain in China. It's when a new, almost imperceptible wave of motion begins and the horizon in front of you shifts and suddenly you're going somewhere completely different. Then you realize you need to be a completely different person inside, too, if you actually want to reach that place. That's exactly what happened to me when I started my career in publishing. My life went in a completely new direction, and it was startlingly and unexpectedly beautiful. And then, the butterfly flapped its wings again about 10 years later, and that particular pivot became one of the most hellish periods in my life, when it felt like the world was cracking me open and dropping me like a runny egg with my gooey insides smashed all over. Then I shifted again, 6 years later, and once more, I was stunned by unimaginable success, followed by almost theatrical, like, tragedy. Each time, however, there was one common theme. I had to transform, to rebuild, to find myself anew, to punch through into the new and discover who I was there. My point is, like you right now as you read this, I'm looking for the next iteration of myself. I'm ready to level up my game and go trekking over new lands. And the feelings that precede this, they're often the ones you feel right now. Listlessness, indecision, frustration, not knowing what the right next thing to do is. Feeling some sort of yearning for more, but not knowing how to get there. Feeling stuck in your job, marriage, or life. Feeling desperately afraid to take some kind of risk or promising gamble. Feeling anxious, feeling emotionally flat and empty, or being wildly unsure. You get the idea. These feelings are your mile markers, and it means there's a turn up ahead. I know you've been here before. You've probably taken as many or more branching paths as I have. The difference is this time we are provoking your reinvention. This time, your inner transformation won't crush you like a tidal wave. No, this time, you have a surfboard. You're going to ride this wave, and it's going to be really, really exciting. You're going to learn a skill that will last the rest of your life. You'll be taking the lead and discovering new bits and pieces of yourself on purpose, with clear intention and desire. You'll get to rearrange that kaleidoscope of you into something more pleasing, more secure, more loved. You'll take stock of all you've done and been, maybe refurbish a few parts, and figure out if you want to go bigger or just get your head above water. It doesn't matter if you're 25 or 55. On our road of growth, we all pause, stumble, and sit in the lonely dirt more than a few times. This time, we get to walk it together. I'm enrolling you in M.E.School, so you can wipe that dusty patch off your butt, get up, start walking with me. You don't have to be burned out or soul weary to be ready for this work. Maybe you've simply maxed out your current success and have been on a frustrating horizontal plateau for too long. Either way, we're going to look at your personal power, the way you think, your life itself, and we're going to figure out what's working and what's not. Okay, you already know what's not working. I get that. And we're going to find alternate ways of thinking and feeling that can and will make enormous changes and even tremendous pleasure inside you. The goal is to get you out of your own saggy lavender pajamas and back into the thick of living joyfully, fully expressed, feeling safe and secure, and with so much dang self-love you practically stagger. Let's do this. Chapter 2. You are not a badass yet, and you know it. This is where I feel like I need to start the chapter by telling you, you are a badass, or you can heal your life, or some rah-rah thing like that. But I know you've heard all that, and you still feel the same. Instead, I'm just going to tell you to be open. Being open means being coachable, and coachable means being willing to try on some new thoughts and play with things that might work to heal you, release you, or just let you be your own damn self in the face of people or places that might not be comfortable with that. It means purposely deconstructing some head trips and things you've told yourself about yourself over the years. If you were an athlete, being coachable means trying some different moves instead of stubbornly insisting on doing the same old things you think work, even when your coach is tearing her hair and screaming at you across the field to shift your weight to the left this time, to the left. Being coached is fun. It's Red Hat Society type fun. If you don't know what the Red Hat Society is, trust me, you will. For now, think about your saucy grandma and her drawn-on eyebrows and stockings sticking out of the toes of her very practical sandals, telling you to stop giving a fuck, wear the goddamn shirt, and stop moaning about how thick your arms look in it. Those are the Red Hat ladies. Amen. Let's start with a deeper peek into M.E.School. I mean, that's part of the subtitle of the book, and that's what you're getting into, right? M.E.School started with a simple premise. You learn to be more effective in your life, rid yourself of old fears and blocks, and set in motion a life of ease, joy, and security, with a dash or two of wonder, by working with both physical and non-physical energy. And we did this. We actually accomplished this over and over as almost 1,000 students passed through its doors. Over time, a larger thread began to weave its way through. It became a school for reinvention, a school for transformation. It became a place and point where everything that's stuck in your life starts moving again, where everything unhealed gets healed, and new choices and opportunities take shape and begin to blossom. A place for you to gain mastery over your life. A place for you to take back your power. That is what you're going to do right here, with me, in this book. In M.E.School, you're going to move through 7 sections, parts 1-7. In the first few chunks, we're going to peel away layers of old ideas, expose the feelings you have right now about yourself and your life, and pump you full of inner revelations. This is when we learn what we're working with right now inside you. Then we'll look at what I call the weasels in the road, those things that make you stumble and that block, thwart, or disappoint you. And again, we'll dismantle them or their importance to you one by one. You'll discover that untangling and revealing inner patterns and blocks is my thing. Finally, you'll reach the last few sections. In these, I'll hand you tool after tool for gaining inner strength, developing or redeveloping purpose, and frankly, just lighting that fire of passion as you move through your own inner reinvention. Each chapter ends with a call to action. These are prompts that mimic the worksheets I give my online classes. I urge you to get a journal and do all of them. They are the meat and bones of the work we do. It can also be fun to do this as part of a book club. Finally, where will you end up? Well, like I said, you might fork onto a whole new path, or you might become fully accepting of yourself as you are and finally see your own inner being in a fantastic and gorgeous new light. Or you might end up doubling down on your current path with renewed zest and fresh focus. I don't know where you'll end up. I'm really curious for you. Curious with you. And that's why I'm doing M.E.School right alongside you. I'm peeling back the process, so it's not something dictated from afar. No, I'll be right by your side, sharing how the shifts feel in me, how they felt in my past students, and how I know what you might be feeling. I've done this before. In fact, I've done this practically every year for the last 10 years as I've taken multiple waves of students through this process. And this time, my crossroads, my pivot point, my moment of reflection might even be similar to yours. I've gone through these last few crazy years with you. I'm stopping at the same checkpoint that calls for reassessing myself and my life as you. During the COVID pandemic, I unexpectedly homeschooled two teens and sent one off to college and became an empty nester. I put on at least 20 pounds and discovered I left my hair's flat iron in the drawer way more than I used it. Ditto makeup. I've been sitting my butt down in front of my computer to work full time, even as I have days to wander my house and ponder the meaning of my life. I'm ready for my next reinvention, the next up-leveling, as are you. This is why it's our perfect timing, the perfect moment for us to both start M.E.School. We are exactly where we need to be. All this means growth is imminent. A fluttering, shimmering butterfly wing, catching the light and asking us to come hither. I am so glad we're doing it together. We're starting with the first thing I teach my class. Reinvention is possible. Do you want it? Chapter 3. Yes, you can reinvent yourself. It's what? Maybe a Thursday? It's late afternoon. Your week kind of sucked. Work was stressful or insanely boring, as usual. Or if it wasn't work, it was school. Or spinning around at home all week, getting shitloads of nothing done, even though everything seemed important at the time. At any rate, you're at a stopping point. A hold-your-horses moment where the rider pulls back on the reins. You're facing your computer, or your phone, or your TV, wondering what's next for you in your life, or if this is all there is. You toy with the idea that you have depression. Maybe you do, maybe you don't. But you do know that what's in front of you for the next 5 years, 10 years, is untenable. I just can't do this anymore, you realize. So, how do you reinvent yourself? Can you even? You Google it. All the articles recommend that you take deep breaths, explore new hobbies. What bullshit. You feel incredibly underwhelmed. This is another Thursday lost in time. I know you know the feeling of doing the same things you've been doing for years and not being sure about their value. I know you also know the feeling of knocking your head against the same wall over and over, hoping eventually something will work out, go big, or get you to that next level of success via a bigger income, a happier home, a relationship, any of 100 things that tell us we've finally broken through to the next level of success, instead of spending yet another night in the foxhole of nothing ever working out. You need to reinvent yourself. I need to reinvent myself. How? You look back on all your past reinventions. They all happened without awareness. You were doing one thing, then slowly began doing another. Then that other thing became your main thing. It was organic. You evolved. Why isn't that happening now? Why do you feel like you're clawing onto the present even as you're wishing it away? Because this time, you're afraid. You have bills to pay. You have kids to support. You have less energy. Your body is sagging and getting tireder earlier, and the thought that you have the time or ability to pivot seems much harder to believe. Your life doesn't feel rolled out in front of you like some long, deep-pile Persian carpet. It feels like a narrow, gray sidewalk choked with old gum. You need to reinvent yourself. I need to reinvent myself. How? First, I take that stupidly long, deep breath. And then I recognize that I'm different. I'm older. I have more seemingly rational reasons why I can't be successful piled up in the deep, dark corners of my mind. I've built up barriers to change that hold me locked into a rigid walled garden of what I can be and how much money I need to earn and how long it'll take me to do anything else. And those walls may very well be absolute bullshit. But for the moment, I'm believing them. Until I stop. Stopping means that I exhale. I give myself time to evolve again. Slowly, like before. I still have the same pressures, the same responsibilities. I have the same fears that what I make or become next won't happen fast enough, be financially supportive enough, or be in any way as good as what I had before. But then I see that what's really happened over time isn't about any of that. It's about trust. Somewhere along the way, our trust broke. The trust that we could reinvent ourselves successfully. There. Stop. Feel it for a second. What if you have utter, total, deep, solid trust, a knowing that reinventing yourself will be wildly and spectacularly successful? You would do it in a hot second. So now we see the key, what we're missing. We no longer have that trust. We used to, back when we just let ourselves shift and evolve without even really thinking it through. But now, every shift is calculated against our potential losses. So how do we fix that? We do it by getting right back to that old original feeling. Reinventing yourself will be wildly, spectacularly successful. Not might be, not has to be, just will be. If you can't feel that, then you are totally 100% committed to staying where you are instead. Nobody takes any leaps if they can't feel themselves successfully on the other side of the chasm. And just because you can't see that chasm doesn't mean it's not there. Nobody put an expiration date on your life and said, you can't have any success after this, no more pivots for you, time's up. Nobody said that but you and your limited, small-minded, untrusting, fearful thinking. Deep breath. You want to reinvent yourself? Here's how. Make time for it. Create space for it. Carve time out in your day to let your mind wander and grow. Cancel the silly time-sucking things you have in your life that keep you distracted from yourself from dawn till midnight. You know what those things are. Tell everyone you know that you have a new hobby and it's non-negotiable. You've committed to redeveloping trust that your invention is going to be wildly successful, and you're giving yourself the time and space to nourish this into reality. Don't give yourself a hard deadline. Your deadline is whenever the pie is baked. It's unknowable right now. Just get the fucker in the oven. Stop thinking that the reinvented you has to be more successful and bigger and better in every way. Maybe the new reinvented you is shy and searching and lovely in your sweet naivety. Be okay with that. We don't know who's going to come out in the new you. All we know is that they've been waiting for you to open the oven and let them out. And last, don't fear it. Don't fear him or her. She isn't losing anything. She's gaining. You give her time and space to emerge, and she gives you your new breath. Stop fearing that you'll lose your income or your family or that you don't have the time or space for this. Start reminding yourself that you've done this before and it was easy last time. It just happened last time. You don't need the buildup of fear around it. That fear is a new thing, and it's a lie. You can pivot right now. Commit, make the time, and do it. Remember, I'm doing it with you. Reinvention is a thing, a real thing, not just a hazy yearning. It needs its own space and a generous, warm welcome. Don't let it be some amorphous longing that you distractedly think about. Make it real. Make it like me right now, today in my gray pajamas, day two, banging away on a keyboard to you. I'm reinventing myself right this moment through this simple act of writing and reflecting. Reinventing myself is what exactly? I don't know yet. In the beginning, you usually don't know. I haven't published a book in 11 years. Maybe I'm going to be an author again. Maybe not. Maybe I'll pull my coaching company apart at the seams and rearrange it into something bigger, brighter, and more relevant than ever. Or maybe I'll pivot completely and become a virtual travel agent specializing in exotic truffle hunts. Maybe I'll go through this with you and discover that I'm just simply ready to retire. Maybe my reinvention is not to get to some bigger, greater, more wildly successful plateau. Maybe it's to learn to just be. To savor the delicious ray of sun peeking through my office window as I listen to my dog slobbering in his sleep. See? I'm open. But no matter what it ends up being, I commit to it. I commit hard. For me, this feels like taking all the other options off the table. By this, I mean, I don't really have other options now, do I? I can sit here in my pajamas for another week, another month, a year, just kind of longing and waiting and growing more frustrated and distracted. But that's not really an option, see? It's a default. Whereas, choosing that feeling of hope and commitment right now is powerful. I reclaim my power, starting right in my heart and gut, when I shake my tiny fist at the universe and say, "Oh yeah, buddy, this is going to happen, and it starts now." Commitment is something that blooms through you. Can you feel it? Can you feel that deep knowing that you are changing and growing, that it's a good thing, and that you are committed to doing it? Prompts are your friends. Yes, every chapter has a task, a prompt. Every student in M.E.School, that's you, has homework to plow through in order to reveal something about them or their life and or to challenge, fix, heal, or grow that thing. For you A-types, I know you want them. Get your notebook and pens and let's start the process. You B-types? You can just glaze through the prompts if you want, but don't be surprised if they come back to haunt you in the shower. That's a good thing. Let them. Speaking of reminder, You can find all of these prompts in a sweet, downloadable format at www.flowdreaming.com/prompts. To use the prompts well, give yourself some time to ponder and answer each question truthfully. If you can't answer or don't understand what you suspect I'm trying to get at, don't worry. I'm not looking for a right and perfect answer. I'm looking for your answer, even if it's, I have no friggin' idea, or too soon, Summer, not going there yet. If you haven't journaled or done any self-reflection in a while, you might be rusty with letting the flow of ideas slip out. That's okay. Put on your uniform. First practice starts today. In this chapter, your prompts are exploratory, meaning you're discovering where you are, what you're bringing to the table right now, as you get this ball rolling. Like I said at the beginning of the last chapter, the key question here is, are you open and coachable? Or like I asked later, are you committed? Dive into these ideas with the following prompts. M.E.School prompt. Your prompt is to commit to your reinvention and take inventory of where you are right now. Journal or reflect on the following questions. Am I committed to my growth or reinvention? Or am I scared or mistrustful or both? What does it feel like to know I want to change more than anything and that I am 100% committed to doing it? What is my overall feeling about my life right now? How good am I at being coached or taught? When I shut down or reject new knowledge, it's usually because I'm feeling being fill in the blank. When I open up and receive new knowledge, it's usually by feeling being fill in the blank. Chapter 4, Between the Reefs. Out past the reef is the blue, blue ocean. Wide, deep, beautiful. Also, scary, uncertain, directionless. Little fishy, you've been on your reef a long time. You know its crevices, the little hidey holes, even where the eels lay their scary heads. You've got the reef. The reef is good. All your fellow fishies agree. Except, you're getting a little curious about the world. You keep looking with longing over there, past the reef, you little Nemo. What's out there? One day, you venture off your reef. Your friends and family nag you and ask, what's wrong with you? Your friends and family have seemed like scared little whiners lately. So annoying. Negative Nellies. Gripe, gripe. Just do something about your problems, you want to yell. And they don't. But you're doing something about yours. That's why you found yourself at the end of the reef. And right now, you're floating in the vast blue ocean. It feels vulnerable. You feel exposed and silly. You want your old reef buddies, but you know the second you go back, you're going to feel even more out of place. You've already been too far out. You wonder if there'll ever be another reef. You've entered the grow zone. The grow zone is where you've never been before. It's full of new experiences. Many of these experiences make you feel insecure and uncertain. You have no prior experience with them. Back on the reef, you are in the known zone. The known zone is super safe. It's also super boring after a while. The grow zone is always alluring because the more you experience it, the more pieces and parts of you get revealed. You didn't know you liked Italians until you dated one. You didn't know you could yodel until you went to Switzerland. You had no idea you'd fall for a gal who does cosplay on the weekends. You've discovered a lot about yourself. You've expanded. You've grown. Still, There's this moment between leaving the known zone and encountering the new delights ahead where we pause. Our little fins quiver. We want to reach backward, but we can't. Forward is still murky blue. A part of our mind is screaming that we should not have done this. It will be bad. That's the part that's built to keep us safe. And we feel anything but safe in this big blue ocean. But then, you spot it. A reef. A big, colorful reef with fish unlike any you've ever seen. And when you get there, your old reef friends are resentful. They feel abandoned. Truthfully, they could meet you on the new reef anytime if they wanted to. They don't want to. Yet. But someday they will. And then you can show them around your new known zone. Somebody always has to be the leader, even if they don't know they are. So swim, little fishy. Your next grow zone awaits. The grow zone. The grow zone, familiar? Or rather, it's never exactly familiar, since being in it means you're in a new place, charting new waters. But the feeling of being in a grow zone is familiar. It's weird, funky, a little or a lot scary. It's where the stuff behind you is no longer working for you, but no new stuff has presented itself yet. It's the lost middle of the road trip between the two points of your destination. Here's another example, my own. After about a decade, I left the mega publisher who'd hired me. Or rather, they fired me. It super sucked because I was no longer just a book designer there. Nope, I had risen. A super famous author who founded the company was my boss's boss. I had a weekly live radio show on the internet and Sirius XM, co-hosting with another super famous personal growth leader. I'd been given a multi-million dollar division of the company to run, with a big staff, in charge of producing and delivering all their audio content, from audiobooks to live events to dozens and dozens of podcasts by people you've seen on TV, headlining major conferences, and generally game-changing the entire personal growth world. Not only that, but I oversaw the building of multiple sound studios and had launched the company into the internet with newfangled online webinars and an online radio station that was delightfully and hugely embraced by the wellness and metaphysical communities. I was making the company gobs of money by transitioning them into the digital world, and my yearly performance review was always 5-star. I very much believed this was my destiny, and that I was doing a very good job. I'll tell you the whole story later, but in a nutshell, I found myself suddenly unemployed, crying into my bathroom sink, feeling very, very much between the reefs. Imagine the best thing you ever had, that you've stuffed a decade of your life into, that you just based taking a mortgage out on, being taken away in a heartbeat of an afternoon for no discernible reason. Actually, maybe you've had that happen to you too. It felt like life had said, "Fuck you, Summer. You've had enough of the good stuff. Bye. Oh, and good luck ever getting something like this again, babe." Yes, my evil inner thoughts all sound like misogynistic men. Sorry, guys. I do love you. Sometimes you end up between the reefs by force, not by choice. Like when you discover your partner is cheating, when your employer fires you, or when your doctor tells you they need more tests. Unlike me, I don't want you spending the next 3 years with a horrible stress-induced health condition, not knowing what the hell to do next, not realizing that life was indeed working just like it should. Because if that event hadn't happened, I'd never have built my own multi-million dollar personal growth brand, Flow Dreaming. I'd never have invented M.E.School. I'd never have awakened to my true calling, the very thing my prior career had quietly skilled me to do. I probably wouldn't even be sharing this book with you right now, and you and I would never meet. And the changes in you, which I hope will flow from sharing this book, would never have come to be. Instead, I'd still be humping my way into work at 6:30 a.m. and winding up at 6 p.m., missing my kids growing up, and throwing myself ever more into my job just to get ahead, which by now would have turned me into a bitter wad of despair. But nah, life sent me between the reefs, where it was super lonely. Life was not giving me any hint of direction, and super scary. The only way to pay the bills was by building my own company, because I could not think of any other thing to do. And well, my little idea called flow dreaming was catching on. And this is what brings me to the next stage in our journey. Realizing that you're already enough, that you're where you need to be right now, this very second, and that you are worth every damn droplet of goodness in the universe. But first, get your worksheets or your notebook. M.E.School prompt. Your prompt is to recognize your grow zone and your level of comfort about being in one. Journal or reflect on the following questions. How do my grow zones feel? Am I in one now? What precipitated my latest grow zone? Was it a big life change? Or was it more like a slow, creeping one? Am I trying to escape my grow zone as fast as I can because I absolutely hate it? Or am I open to settling in for the ride? How uncomfortable am I comfortable feeling? Can I go past that and commit to feeling even a little more uncomfortable? Do I want something to change me? What am I waiting for? Chapter 5. Are You Worthy? Let's play with an idea. Let's say you're born as a scrawny, screaming baby with pretty much no worth. I mean, you may or may not even be loved by your parents. But if you are loved, are you worthy of that love? In this scenario, no, you are not. You see, your worth is going to be created as you grow. You're an empty character with no experience in the game. Do good things, become more worthy. Do bad things, become less. You're pretty much empty of worth, but ready to make yourself worthy by all your future life choices. It's the old good girls go to heaven, bad girls go to hell model. We're basically racking up heaven points or we're losing them. Contrast this to intrinsic worth. With intrinsic worth, that fidgety little baby is born worthy. Just being blessed with your first gulp of air assures you that you are worthy enough to be here. You made it. Life or God or whatever felt you had enough merit to come here. And maybe you got lucky and live in a plush, upscale home, or maybe you'll be walking barefoot down a sewage-filled street. Those are your external circumstances. They have no bearing on your inner intrinsic worth. All men are created equal, of equal worth, with an equal right to pursue happiness. No one is inherently more worthy than another. If this is the case, your only job is to fully express that worth in the world, to allow it, build from it, create from it. You have nothing to prove, no points to gain. You are already cleared for great things, and now it's just about expressing them and letting them out. No one can doubt you or say you don't have what it takes. We all have what it takes. If you live a scared, retractive, mean, small life, you've taken your intrinsic worth and misplaced it. You've ignored it, don't believe in it, and gone around thinking you have to accomplish things to get it. You're on a constant merry-go-round of trying to gain worth and then losing it through getting people to love you, validate you, give you money, or whatever. In this model, you never really win. On the other hand, if you live a bountiful, fully realized, fully expressed life, Then you've unlocked your intrinsic inner worth to impact the world in marvelous ways. No one here gave it to you, so no one here can take it away. This means if you want to be something great, you already have permission. If you fail at it, so what? You are still worthy to be loved, adored, cherished, admired, and supported. That never goes away. Now, what model do you believe in? You already love yourself, mostly. If I were channeling Louise Hay, this is where I'd say, you've got to learn to love yourself. But I'm not saying learn to love yourself. The problem with that is that we all do love ourselves to some degree. We just don't love all of ourselves. We think we have to do more, be more, or climb more to become that beautiful, lovable person we want to be. We've taken our intrinsic worth, set it aside, and instead focused on a litany of all the crappy shit in us that needs fixing. And then personal growth is happy to step in and tell you where you fail. Well, guess what? In even the nicest homes, the toilet breaks. Having a broken toilet doesn't mean there's no worth there. It means you live in a body with a life where you sometimes do crummy things or crummy things get done to you. You are still worthy of everything. And you should love your broken, janky toilet self as much as you love your big bay windows self. But I promise you, we won't be shoulding here. Instead, I want you to be thinking about how much you think you have to change yourself in some better way to finally get what you want or have your life look like you want. A lot of us discover that personal growth is a moving horizon. We're always on our way to it, but never reaching it. Happiness is always one mountain range away, because we have forgotten one very important thing. Not only are you intrinsically worthy, but right now, in this moment, you are also at the literal apex of your life. Right now, you have the greatest amount of wisdom you've ever had. You have the most life experience you've ever had. You've had the most successes and the most failures. You've had more experiences in relationships and how to navigate their tumbling waters than you've ever had before. Your tool belt for life is bulging with all the miscellaneous items you've picked up or discovered through the years. It has never been fuller or heavier than it is at this moment. Kind of a profound thought. Chances are, you have tools for almost everything, and certainly more than you did 5 years ago or even 20. And the ways you dealt with things 5 years ago or 20 probably won't ever be repeated. How could they possibly be repeated? Back then, you only had a hammer. Now you have a hammer, circular saw, and a whole freaking factory line. You are not the old you, and you'll never be again. So why do you still think you're not going to be successful or happy or in love or whatever else it is you want? You are the best person you've ever been right this second. Yes, the best. Even if you don't particularly like yourself at this second, you can't argue that you're not the most wise, most experienced, and most knowledgeable you've ever been. You've got more inner resources than ever, so why the self-doubt? Don't you think it's silly that the more skilled we've become, the more we fear making changes and taking leaps? Leaps into new lives, new partnerships, new work, new anything? We fear all the bad things that could happen, instead of recognizing that we're better equipped than we've ever been to make those same things never happen again. You've been working on this culmination of you for your entire lifetime. Every second, you're bigger, better, and more capable than the second before. The slow drip of time itself has done that for you. You didn't even have to work for it. It just is. I don't fear I'll ever be fired from my dream job again, since now I made my own dream job. I'm the only one who can fire me. I won't ever be that gal 12 years ago who didn't have all the insights, wisdom, and inner resources I have now. I also don't fear that I'll never find a new career path or rebuild my career from the ashes, because I've done that too. If I did it once, I can do it again. See, you really are in the best place you've ever been. You literally can't be that old you. They're gone. You would never make the same decisions, be caught in the same circumstances. Nope, gone. I think you may not realize that you're already where you need to be, right now, right this moment. There is no more waiting and no more fearing. If you're still waiting to get ripe like a fat avocado dangling from a tree, consider this instead. Maybe you've already ripened, and now you hang there, still waiting. M.E.School prompt. Your prompt is to ask yourself, what am I waiting for? Use the prompts below to explore your intrinsic worth, your secret fears, and all those things you're waiting for so you can feel like the amazing, gorgeous person that you are. What do I think I need to do or become to finally feel security, greatness, life purpose, or whatever my goal is? If I believed that life would support me with anything because I am already worthy of it, what would I be doing or how would I be living? What are my secret fears? And what can't I do because of them? Where am I not good enough, smart enough, handsome enough, likable enough, popular enough, seen enough, etc.? Am I projecting my ideas onto other people and presuming they're judging me the same way I am? Part 2. Grip the Tools. Chapter 6. The King and the Queen. This morning, we settle in with black coffee. I'll admit, I'm still in my nighttime sweats, but it's only 8:30 on a Saturday morning. I'll let it pass. Finally, we're getting to the good stuff, the heart of M.E.School. The where you go next, now that you know that even though you're between the reefs, you're actually super ready to see what this already worthy person that you are is going to do with herself next. The heart of the work you're about to do requires your emotion, not your thoughts, not your logic. It requires your heart and the seemingly endless conflict between what you know, what you feel, and what you actually do. There's a really rational reason for how you got into this life-stopping, soul-crushing standoff between your rational mind and your wistful heart. Reinvention begins with igniting your inner queen. The queen is your heart. Yet, trusting your heart to lead you is about the hardest thing you can do. If you're an overachiever, I feel for you. I really do. After all, your intellect has led you to all the great stuff you have right now, whilst your heart would have sent you down 1,000 rabbit holes to nowhere. No wonder you trust your head over your heart. You've never given your heart a chance to prove itself. Why start now? On the other hand, maybe you've trusted your head to make the so-called right decisions, but instead it's made tons of decisions that were piss-poor bad. You won't listen to your heart, but you don't trust yourself to make good rational choices either. Your heart is tied to a stake, bound, and gagged inside you as your rational self relentlessly keeps you on the so-called right track, doing the things you should do that should lead you to growth and safety, but which instead lead you to daily, mind-numbing misery. You're left lost in a fog of indecision, self-doubt, and failure, unable to make a choice you can stand behind. How do we help these poor, lost babies? I call the head your king and the heart your queen. together, they should rule the kingdom equally. And this isn't some gender thing. Think of it as an old-fashioned parable or myth where opposites take these roles. In fact, your queen may be a cis man, your king gender fluid, doesn't matter. The role of your heart, the queen, is to tell you all those most important things like, I'm falling in love, or I love my kids more than anything on earth, or I don't know why, but I have to say yes to this. It feels so right. She drives you into new territory. She makes you vulnerable and open. She's the fierce explorer who stands on the castle parapets and dreams of what's beyond those green hills out there. Conversely, the king wants nothing more than to keep you safe and fed. He'll tell you, don't go out of these castle doors. You don't know what's out there. It will probably hurt you. We have food and warmth in here. The two sit in despair on their thrones, hardly speaking. The king has a strong argument for keeping you safe. After all, he takes all the things you've ever learned or experienced, adds them together, and says, this works and this doesn't. Listen to me, and I will read through everything that's already happened to you and extrapolate it into your future so I can tell you what you should do next. Smart man, this king. The queen wails back, yes, but if I only guide my future by what's happened in my past, my world starts to shrink. You can only forecast based on what you've already experienced, and here we are going over the same hallways day in and day out, and my heart is dying inside. Life should be about growth, not safety. The king stands his ground. Life should be about safety, not growth.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.